Hey guys, Solomon here. Hope you're having a great day. I thought as we continue Hippo Week, I could cover a game that is potentially my best Hippo game in an over-the-board tournament setting to this point in time. I'm not posting this game, guys, to brag, right? I'm not trying to do that and just throw off my greatest games and make you guys think I'm the greatest player ever, right? That's not why I'm doing it. I'm really just showing this game because I think that it can help you guys, right? I think it's instructional. And the reason I think that it's instructional is because it's down to earth, right? This isn't, you know, Kasparov versus Topalov, which is amazing to watch. But at the same time, we're all sitting there like, how on earth did Kasparov play that? And how on earth could I try to replicate that? This is a game in which case I just follow principled chess, right? Chess strategy in general, and also ideas, themes, and concepts that are used in the Hippo, right? A lot of the ideas and concepts in the Hippo I will be introducing in this video. If you haven't, you know, seen or heard or played the Hippo ever before in your life, and if you're interested in learning more about the Hippo and growing your skills with this system, I made a course which is over 6 hours long. I have a link to it in the description below, and you can go check it out if you're interested. But okay, I mean, let's get into the game. Round three in the tournament I was playing down in SoCal. I think at this point I was 1 out of 2. I had just lost to a FIDE master in round one, and then I beat a 2100 in round two. Round three, I'm going up against another 2100 level player. He starts out with the game with e4, and you know, my preferred move order is g6, bishop g7, and d6, right? 1, 2, 3, very easy. White can't really stop it. And okay, once I do have my pawn on d6, the moment that I see that bishop on c4, I just lock it down. I don't want to mess with it. I don't want to mess with that bishop. There's sometimes bishop takes f7 check ideas, getting trappy lines. Just lock the bishop down. Okay, that's my advice to you. Lock the bishop down. There's no reason not to. You know, white here plays bishop f4, and I just continue as usual. Okay, you know, developing h6. I don't want to allow that bishop into h6, right? So I play h6, preventing that. And okay, knight ge2. And now I play a6, right? So first off, white does have somewhat of an obscure setup, right? Not obscure per se, but just different than what we usually see, right? Usually white has a two-pawn center on d4 and e4. Here, they have that c4 to e4 kind of direction, right? And when you see this, when you see pawns pointed towards the king side, white is probably going to try to attack on the king side, right? In fact, in this game, white does try to eventually get in a f5 break. But okay, I play this move of a6. Right, the whole idea being that I could play b6, right, and there's nothing wrong with that, but if I play a6, I could potentially play b5, gaining a tempo against the bishop and also gaining space, right? Usually here I see something like a4 from white, and then I play b6, and I just continue playing the hippo. a4 is what I was expecting, but instead I see the move of a3, right? Interesting choice there from white. I just develop my knight, play b5, gaining space, and then bishop b7. So we have finally reached move 10. The hippo setup, right? That full thick-skinned hippo. The only difference is that I don't have 6 pawns on the 6th rank, but instead only 5, right? Because I have that pawn on b5. But that kind of just gives me an extra tempo, right? More space, more tempo, more freedom to move. This is great for us, right? White here plays bishop e3. This is something, you know, I'm playing up against a 2100 level player, solid expert level player. You know, I see this all the time. Players move the same piece twice once they see this setup and they're trying to kind of figure out what they're going to do against it. I play knight b6 now, tucking my knight straight behind. I wasn't too worried about bishop takes because then I go up the bishop pair, and sure, I have double pawns, but all these pawns are pretty nicely clumped together and they're very solid, hard for white to break through. So okay, white plays rook e1, and I play c5. Now usually with a two pawn center here, playing c5 takes a little bit more work, right? Especially with the bishop on e3, I might have to support that c5 pawn a little bit. But in this case, if you have this kind of pawn structure, play c5, right? If white has this kind of pawn structure, play f5, gaining space, right? But in this case, okay, c5, if you're going to give me space, I'll take it. f4 from white, I play queen c7, knight g3 is played, and now d5, right? I'm trying to expand here. I'm threatening to play d4, and because of that, white plays d4 themselves, preventing this center fork trap, right? Attacking the bishop and the knight. White could have taken on d5, but I wasn't worried about it. One of the nice things about the hippo is that when we use one of the four middle game attacking ideas, which is, you know, moving either b or g and then tucking a knight straight behind, in this case, we have two knights, a bishop, and a pawn, and usually a queen as well, all attacking slash defending d5. So d5 is the natural break that you're going to want to make after you go with b5 and knight b6, right? But in this case, I just have a lot of support, right? I could take with a knight. I could take with the bishop. I could take with a knight again. Notice back in this case, I actually took with the bishop first because I'd rather have a knight on d5 than a bishop here personally. Going back, this knight's very active, right? Hard for white to have to deal with. I'm threatening knight takes e3, followed by bishop d4, pinning a rook or a queen to the king on g1. I'm also looking at that pawn on b2, and just a great space advantage here. Also notice the moment that white captured on d5, if they did this, f5, we have a double pawn clamp on that square. So f5, which is really white's hope here, isn't going to get played, at least if, you know, they don't want to lose a pawn. So, okay, going back, I play that move of d5. White continues to d4, right, not taking, keeping this f5 option alive and also preventing d4. In this case, I end up taking. And now we have move 17. Notice this move 17, and I have not castled yet. Sometimes in the hippo, I castle quickly, but there is some value in the hippo of not castling right away because it's hard for white to figure out where you're going, right? Are you going kingside? Are you going queenside? And our king, guys, we have two knights right in front of our king, two pawns on the sixth rank, two bishops being shadowed. Our king is safe, right? So there's not necessarily a rush to castling, unless, of course, you're trying to, you know, use an f8 rook and support, you know, a wing push like f5 or something like that. You know, to kind of show you what I'm thinking there, for those of you that aren't, you know, super well, you know, whatever the word is, immersed in the coordinates of chess, you know, castling kingside so that we have a rook on f8 supporting an f5 push. That's kind of what I'm speaking of there. Overall, though, there's not a huge rush of, you know, castling. So in this case, I do have to castle, though, right? It's move 17. It's time to castle. It's time to do it, right? And, you know, looking at castling kingside, I just didn't like this here. I didn't like it at all. A queen is looking right down my throat here on f6, g7, and h8 because I just did trade off my dark square bishop. On top of that, f5 can happen. We have two rooks and a bishop also looking directly at my king. And, of course, some of you may be going, well, if I do castle here, I mean, there's three pawns in the way of the bishop, right? But all that being said, guys, you never know when things can break open. All it takes is a move like f5 and us taking on e4, and white is blasting that game open right up against our king. So here I end up castling queenside. I think my king is a lot safer on this side of the board. And something that can help, guys, is just counting the pieces, right? I mean, let's just play this move, castling kingside. Let's cut the board in half. How many defenders does black have, right? We're not counting pawns, only pieces. A knight and a rook. That's it, right? And sometimes you can look at the other side of the board as well, but this queen on c7, I don't think it's a defender here, in all honesty. And if you count white's attacking pieces, they have 1, 2, 3 on the king side, and I'm counting this queen as well because it's very active. And even this bishop over here, even though it's on the other side of the board, I'm counting it as a strong attacking piece. So, you know, I mean, we're looking at, what, 5 attacking pieces against 2 defenders? I'm good, right? So going back, I instead castle queenside. Let's cut the board in half now, right? Let's cut this board in half. And first off, just see what pieces are placed on the queenside. White here with 1, 2, 3. Black with 1, 2, 3, 4, right? 4 to 3, I'm taking that. On top of that, I do think that the knight on e7 is a solid defender here, you know, covering squares like d5 and c6 as well. Part of my little slip up there. But yeah, I mean, this is, you know, just a solid position. And the rooks here, they're potentially active, but they're not really that threats against my king at the moment, per se. And I think here's really the key moment of the game. I think this is really where white made a mistake. And that was the move of e5, okay? e5, guys, just isn't a great move. Okay, now what white should have done was played a move like queen f6 or queen g7, try to attack this pawn on f7, and then try to break things open with f5, right? Crazy, you know, this is what Stockfish recommends. Crazy stuff happens, but white's just trying to break the position open. e5 is played, though, and then now it's black. That's the one who is in the driver's seat. In fact, when I was playing the game, I thought to myself, dang, this is the hippo player's dream, this position. Let's talk about why, right? Well, first off, white's pawns are very advanced, right? White has pawns on f4 and e5, which usually means that the f5 square is weak, right? On top of that, if we look at the central pawns, by central, I mean the pawns on the E and D files and those two alone, white has one central pawn, we have two, okay? What we want in the hippo is for the opponent to lock things up and overextend their position because there's going to be cracks in the wall, right? You keep pushing, you keep pushing, you keep pushing, you keep pushing, you keep doing it. Eventually, there's going to be some cracks there, right? So in this case, what are the cracks in the wall? What outposts can we try to gain, right? Let's look at it. First off, let's compare piece to piece. This is something that can help you guys not only in the hippo, but just in chess in general. Let's go piece to piece and see which one is better, right? Let's look at these knights. Which one's better? Well, this knight on c3 isn't very great. I mean, it's attacking two pawns that are very well defended. It can't even move to the fourth rank. Its only squares are one of these. I mean, and if you try to look at potential outposts, you could go, okay, I mean, white would love to go to one of these squares, but the knight just can't get there because all the squares before that are simply taken away, right? Simply taken away. I guess, you know, white could try to get a knight to g4, but the moment that white is about to do that, we could play h5, preventing that from happening, right? But okay, this knight here, I mean, I guess you could do something like this, but it just, I mean, 1, 2, 3, 4, it takes a long time. This knight, on the other hand, one move away from playing knight c4, right? This knight here, again, I mean, you're just a long way from doing anything, you know, and black, on the other hand, one move away from f5, right? Very solid square for the knight. So I think both of our knights are better than their knights. What about the bishops? I think our bishop's better, right? Because this bishop's kind of just staring at d5, which is very well defended. Our bishop, in all honesty, isn't very great at the moment, but I do think it has better potential, which is why I call it our better bishop, because if we can knock this queen off and then play d4, this bishop is going to become a monster. And that's what I was thinking about here, right? Not just pieces, but pawn breaks. Finally, if you compare the rooks, I think that both of our rooks are better too, because this h8 rook can support a pawn push, and this d rook can support d4 at some point. What are these rooks doing, right? They're kind of just locked down. And f5 can't happen because we have a double clamp on that square, right? On top of that, what about pawn breaks? I don't really see here how white can make any kind of substantial pawn break. You know, by pawn break, I mean a move that kind of has an impact on our overall structure. A4, I mean, you could play it, but I mean, it's kind of awkwardly defended. And this is probably the best one I see. C4 can't happen, double clamp on that square. F5 definitely can't happen either. Black, on the other hand, I saw two here. One of them was pushing this h pawn. The other one was the d pawn at some point. I could have played knight f5, which is totally playable, but I ended up not playing it right away because white could take, and then on f5, I have a pawn. I don't want a pawn there. I want a knight, right? So I play this move of h5 and h4 and then look to play knight f5. But here I play the move knight c4 first, just kind of, you know, dropping my knight in. Queen f2 is played. And I think a lot of players here would probably take the pawn, and the computer says this is fine. And when I was going over the game, I was thinking to myself, this is probably a good move, right? Stockfish probably likes this, but I know that I'm a human. I know that I make mistakes. Why would I give white the opportunity to start getting counterattacking chances? Why would I give them a choice, right? Play simple chess to get the win, not the complicated heroic way when you can, right? Sometimes you got to play crazy and find the best moves and hang on for dear life, but if you don't have to, why do it? So, okay, knight c4, queen f2. Again, I don't take here. I instead just play it cool, right? I play h3, and now I play knight f5. By the way, with h3, white could have captured, but then I capture back with the rook. The other rook slides over, black there with a great game. So, okay, g3, now I get my knight in. I'm threatening to throw a knight into e3. So at this point, you know, white captures on c4. I take back with the d pawn, right? You know, with this kind of pawn structure, I talk about this in the course, with all these pawns facing c4, if I throw a knight in and it gets captured, you gotta take with a d pawn, right? Get that bishop activated. And notice there's really nothing that can step in the bishop's way, and I'm looking to play this move of queen c6, threatening a mate. And again, how are you gonna step in front? If you play queen g2, we have mate. If you play queen f3, we're gonna take the queen and the rook. Knight e4 can't do anything. So white here plays the move of g4, right? Trying to kick my knight around. I play queen c6, threatening a mate in one, and here white plays knight g3. Now, at first I was looking at taking this knight, but it turns out that, sure, I can get queen h1, but then king f2 happens, and oddly enough, my attack is starting to kind of fizzle out a little bit, right? It's hard for me to find anything concrete here. So going back against knight g3, white is stopping that mate, and they are stopping this one, right? But if I play knight e3, the queen can't capture, because of mate, and I'm attacking two rooks and the pawn on g4. White tries to solve this by taking the rook, but okay, now I just take off the pawn. And it turns out here, I don't just have this diagonal owned, but this one as well, from A7 to G1. There's nothing that can step in the way. I mean, I guess the queen could technically, but then we're just going to win the queen, right? So king f1 is played. I'll play bishop g2 with check, and here white resigns the game because they're forced to give up their queen. Okay, going back, the main point of the game here, right? e5, right? At this point, you got to start looking at kind of visualizing, what is my plan in the hippo? I want to throw a knight into c4, very common idea in the hippo. I want to throw my knight into f5, very common idea. In this case, can I put a pawn on h3? Make this game break open, play a move like d4, get my bishop involved, right? Think about, you know, what pawn breaks does my opponent have? What pawn breaks do I have? Can they improve their pieces? Can I improve mine? I think after playing e5, white's pieces kind of just had to sit around while black had the ability to continue improving, right? So again, I hope you guys enjoyed that game, and I hope you guys got something out of it. And yeah, keep it real, keep it chill, keep the hippo rolling. Peace. Hey guys, wanted to give a big shout out to my Patreon supporters for the month of February in 2023. Appreciate you guys a ton. And if you haven't checked out the Patreon before, make sure to go check it out. There's a lot of Patreon exclusive benefits that you can gain, and I'd love to have you join the crew.